Welcome to the Hydrogen Village. My name is Bob, and today we're looking at how hydrogen can be used to power vehicles with zero emissions and help us transition to a low-carbon society. We're going to have some straight talk with people on the front lines of the hydrogen movement to get a sense of the progress being made and to understand the challenges that they're working to overcome. We'll also look at some actual hydrogen vehicles and technology development underway right here in Toronto and in other parts of Canada. But first, to learn about the basics of hydrogen vehicles, we're visiting the head offices of Toyota Canada in Scarborough. Toyota has generously provided us with a Mirai to inspect and to take for a spin. Now, at first glance, there's nothing to suggest that this car is unusual, but it's actually electrically powered and that electricity is produced on board using a hydrogen fuel cell. Come on, let me show you around. Refueling this car is remarkably similar to gasoline-powered cars. Here's where the hydrogen goes. There's a nozzle, and you go to a retail hydrogen refueling station and attach the dispenser. In about 3 to 5 minutes, about 6 kilograms of hydrogen are dispensed onto the vehicle and it's stored in pressure cylinders. And that provides enough driving range for about 650 kilometers before you need to refuel. But if you really know what you're doing, you can squeeze a lot more range out of this vehicle. A record was set a couple of years ago where the drivers were able to get 1,300 kilometers on a full fill. So under the hood, we have the fuel cell. And the fuel cell is like the engine of the car. It's where all the power is generated. The fuel cell is supplied with hydrogen from the hydrogen tanks. And that hydrogen is mixed with oxygen in the fuel cell. And the oxygen is drawn from the outside air. When the hydrogen fuel and the oxygen come together, they form water. And in that process, they also release energy in the form of electricity. And this car harnesses the electricity to power the wheels and all the onboard systems. And the only emission that's produced in the process is water vapor. Now, a vehicle of this size and a fuel cell stack like we see here generates about 180 horsepower to the wheels. So it's very comparable to what you would see in a gasoline-powered car of equivalent size and make. So as you can see, the water that was formed in the fuel cell is now being ejected out the back of the car. This is just water, non-polluting, and doesn't contribute to climate change. Enough talk, let's go for a drive. So the vehicle technology is ready, but the hydrogen refueling infrastructure is lagging behind. What can we do about this? Well, this is one of the reasons why the Hydrogen Village was created. It was intended to mobilize experts in hydrogen systems and make that expertise available to communities and businesses and individuals who are looking at adopting hydrogen systems and technologies into their lives. So what we've learned is that this car is fully electric and zero emission, but it doesn't need to be recharged. Instead, you refuel it with hydrogen. And that's part of the challenge. There aren't many convenient places to roll up with your car and fuel up with hydrogen. But that's also an opportunity. Other jurisdictions around the world are tackling this problem. And with the right public and private support, it can be done here in Ontario too. We've now come to Allman Equipment in Rexdale, where hydrogen fuel cell electric semi-trucks are being built. We're going to see how the technology we saw used in the Toyota Mirai can scale up to power larger vehicles. In the Mirai, we learned that hydrogen goes into the fuel cell and water comes out, and this process generates the electricity to power the car. That same principle is being used in large transport trucks for moving freight. Now, although this work is underway here in Toronto, these trucks are in fact Alberta-bound, where they will haul freight between Calgary and Edmonton as part of the Alberta Zero Emissions Truck Electrification Collaboration, or AZATEC. It's a group of forward-looking companies and organizations from different sectors who have come together to show that hydrogen is ready to help transition heavy-duty transport to a low-carbon future. So, let's go meet Jamie Alley, the Vice President of Engineering here at Allman Equipment, and ask him if he'll show us around the project. Great to meet you, Jamie. Thanks for taking time to speak with us today. Tell us a little bit about the AZATEC project. What is the goal?
The AZATEC project is a project to build two 63.5-ton double-trailer trucks for the AMTA, which will run back and forth between Edmonton and Calgary every day.
And what is Allman's role in this initiative?
We received these Freightliner Cascadias, the two Freightliner Cascadias, which are equipped with an electric drivetrain, and we are integrating the hydrogen storage system and the hydrogen fuel cell system.
So this work is going on here in Toronto. When can we expect to see these trucks on the road in Alberta?
They'll be operating in Alberta later this year, and one truck will go to Bison and another to Trimac, which are two of Canada's largest carriers, and they'll operate them between Calgary and Edmonton. It's been really exciting since the Azotec project was announced. There's been a lot of interest from other carriers, other trucking companies, as well as governments, and even the OEMs and Tier 1 suppliers.
Well, certainly diesel is the predominant fuel in freight transport using trucks now. What are the qualities of hydrogen that make it attractive to transition from diesel?
Any carrier or government that wants a zero emission solution for long haul trucking would look to battery electric for shorter range or smaller payload missions, and to hydrogen to extend the range and payload of battery electric trucks.
So with hydrogen, the refueling experience is fast and convenient. What kind of range would you expect to see from vehicles in the future of this make?
800 kilometers to 1,000 kilometers are definitely achievable today, and 1,000 kilometers has even been demonstrated. And it could get beyond that, depending on the hydrogen infrastructure that gets built, the pressure, the operating pressure of that infrastructure, as well as advances in onboard hydrogen storage technologies.
How long before you think we see more and more of these types of trucks on the road in the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area?
That's a great question. It really depends on the interest of the government as well as local companies to be the early adopters of this technology. We need hydrogen infrastructure to be rolled out. And then we need customers, like trucking companies, to step up and be the early adopters as the volumes increase.
Thanks so much, Jamie. We've learned a lot, and we'll continue to follow the Azotec project as it develops.
Thanks, it was a pleasure.
So I think a trend is beginning to emerge. We started by taking a drive in a sedan that was electrically driven using hydrogen fuel cells, and now we see it can work for big semi-transport trucks too. But they both face the same barrier to widespread use, and that is a lack of hydrogen supply and refueling service. Now, I was excited to learn that Azotec trucks will use fuel cells built by Ballard Powered Systems, which is based in Vancouver, British Columbia, because I happen to know that Ballard fuel cells are already powering a freight locomotive in Alberta. And I know just the person to talk to about that.
We're shifting from road to rail now. I happen to know that the fuel cells being integrated into the semi-trucks we saw at Allman Equipment are of the same type that are being used to power freight locomotives developed by the Canadian Pacific Railway in Alberta. Now, if fuel cells can perform under the punishing conditions of freight rail in Canada, then we can expect them to do well in road vehicles too. Freight locomotives already use electric motors to turn the wheels to haul trains. That's because electric motors are excellent at producing the force needed to pull the enormous weight of a train up to speed from a standstill. The electricity for the motors is usually generated using a diesel engine on board, but under the CP Hydrogen Locomotive Program, the motors rely on hydrogen fuel cells to generate the electric tractive power. Kyle Mulligan, the chief engineer at CP, leads this program, and he's joining us from Calgary to give us an update. Kyle, thanks so much for taking time to speak with us today. So tell me a little bit about building these locomotives. What is the process and the design at work?
When we approached the design project, we weren't looking to develop a net new locomotive. We were looking to develop, in our view, modernization, or what we call retrofit kits, to these locomotives. We are ultimately going to have to convert all of our fleet, and the capital cost of buying, you know, over 30,000 locomotives that need to be replaced within the next 30 years, that's a significant investment. And so if you can develop this technology and validate it in terms of a conversion kit, then that allows you to rapidly convert these locomotives at much less the capital cost that you would versus building a net new locomotive.
So your first locomotive has been successfully converted and tested and is actually performed in revenue service for customers. Can you tell us a little bit about the performance of the equipment? Has it met your expectations?
I would say the equipment has not only met our expectations, but certainly surpassed them. From an operator standpoint, we've received feedback from operating employees who operate diesel electric locomotives every day. And they have been thoroughly impressed with the handling of the locomotive and the fact that it essentially is seamless to them in terms of how they operate.
So how do you keep these locomotives fueled with hydrogen? Where do they go to refuel? What's that side of the equation look like?
At CP, we've installed fixed fueling infrastructure as part of the ERA grant that we were able to obtain. In addition to that, we are working with other suppliers of hydrogen who are either transporting gaseous hydrogen trailers on site, so we can just fuel the locomotives where they are. We are actually looking at setting up things like liquefied storage on site and setting up regular deliveries of hydrogen to those sites. So we wouldn't necessarily be a manufacturing our own hydrogen, but we would have a supply chain and on-site storage of hydrogen.
Kyle, thanks so much for the chat today. It's so exciting to see this innovation happening in Alberta. We look forward to seeing what comes next.
Thank you very much, Bob.
The experience at CP shows that fuel cell vehicle technology can scale up and work in some of the heaviest modes of transportation. Now, railways already operate their own diesel locomotive refueling stations. Likewise, CP will simply build its own hydrogen refueling stations where needed to keep their fuel cell electric zero-emission locomotives running. That may provide part of the foundation from which a broader hydrogen fuel supply chain can develop, which would help to lower the barriers to adopting hydrogen vehicle technology on road. To see how we do this, let's go to a place where clean hydrogen is being made in the Toronto area and talk to a local expert in hydrogen infrastructure. So we've seen that hydrogen is being used to power a range of vehicles, from personal cars to heavy-duty vehicles to freight locomotives. And we've spoken with some of the people in the organizations who are leading the transition to fuel cell zero-emission vehicles. We can see that the vehicle technology is working, but access to hydrogen as a vehicle fuel is limited, and this could discourage adoption. Without hydrogen refueling services, we can't use the vehicles, but without the vehicles on the road to serve, building hydrogen infrastructure seems like a bad business. To help us understand how we might clear this logjam and make some progress, I've reached out to Rye Smith at Change Energy Services. His engineering firm is based in Oakville, and they have designed many hydrogen stations around the world. We're meeting here at Enbridge Gas in Markham, at the site of a clean hydrogen production and storage facility, which could be the beginning of a much larger system that one day brings hydrogen to a corner gas station near you. Let's talk to Rye and learn how. Rye, thanks for taking time to speak with us today at Enbridge Gas. We're at the hydrogen facility at the Technical Operations Center, and we're standing beside a pair of very large hydrogen storage tanks. Can you tell us a bit about what's going on here?
Sure. Well, what Enbridge Gas is doing here is they're actually producing hydrogen on site. They're using a process called electrolysis, where they're using electricity from the Ontario power grid, so it's very clean, to split water molecules apart into streams of oxygen and hydrogen.
Is this the first step in an infrastructure that could serve the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area?
Absolutely. This is the kind of thing that is needed to really engender the development of a commercially viable hydrogen operation across the region. A central facility like this is ideal for producing the hydrogen, producing it in the quantities and in the form that is necessary to distribute to applications such as industrial, stationary, and vehicle refueling.
Sounds good. So when can we start using this hydrogen to power our fuel cell electric vehicles?
Well, it's going to take a little bit of development of infrastructure. Infrastructure takes time to develop, as it did for the gasoline. Vehicle refueling infrastructure provides an opportunity to electrify a fleet operation, but without the downtime associated with battery recharging.
So we can't drive up to a corner gas station and fill up with hydrogen now, and yet we have hydrogen being produced and stored here. There's a gap that needs to be bridged. How does that happen? How do we get from where we are here today to where we need to be so that drivers of fuel cell electric vehicles can access hydrogen fuel conveniently?
Because of the infrastructure costs involved in the initial development of hydrogen, it's more likely that we would see fleets of vehicles that are refueled on site as the starting point. And those stations would get larger, and eventually other fleets would be able to use each other's refueling infrastructure. By adding a little bit of extra capacity at each of these facilities, hydrogen is then going to be available for the general public. It'll take a few years, but we'll likely see the hydrogen application start with fleets and move on over time to public vehicle refueling.
Is that the end of it? Is there any role for government in this?
Oh, absolutely. the benefits of using hydrogen are for all of society. And the initial cost is very high. So there's a really good role for government to play in terms of sharing the risk, sharing that initial risk.
What kinds of vehicles and vehicle fleets do you see as the early adopters of hydrogen?
So hydrogen makes the most sense for vehicles that are also in commercial service that can't afford long periods of time being off the road. So what that leads us to is fleets of commercial vehicles that are tend to be medium to heavy duty, but even taxi fleets. If you imagine a fleet of taxis that where the vehicle can't be off the road for very long, they need that quick recharge that hydrogen affords.
What can the average citizen who's concerned about this do? How do they get involved? How do they show their support?
Programs like the Hydrogen Village are a great way for the average person to tap into and learn about the fundamentals of hydrogen and where it's going commercially. So you tap into these resources, find out what's going on, where it's going, and then get to be part of that movement.
Well, it looks like we're at the start of a very exciting future, and I want to thank you for taking time to help us understand how it might progress.
It was my pleasure. Thank you for the opportunity.
So through the course of this video, we've gone for a drive in a hydrogen fuel cell electric passenger car and learned how that same technology can be used to power vehicles as large as freight locomotives. We've also seen how this technology is being integrated into heavy trucks. We spoke with several people working at the leading edge of this movement, and all seem to agree that the technology is ready, but the lack of hydrogen refueling systems is a major barrier. And yet it seems that with some vision and a little coordination, we can get over this bump in the road and accelerate towards our zero emission, low carbon future. On behalf of the Hydrogen Village, I wish to thank you, our viewers, for your interest and attention. I hope that this video has helped to demystify hydrogen fuel cell electric vehicles, how they work, and build awareness of the role hydrogen can play in decarbonizing transportation. Thanks for watching. To learn more, I invite you to visit our website and to become part of the Hydrogen Village.